Hi, my name is Jerry Mikulski, and this is a love letter to the insurance industry and other industries, but as you'll see in a second, the insurance industry is low-hanging fruit. This all starts from an observation I had a couple years ago that most of the insurance industry operates below the joy line. So what do I mean? So picture a line. I pay you money I don't really want to pay you for an event I hope never materializes. We actually sort of both hope it never materializes. But I have in the back of my mind that you might find a little fine print that says that I don't qualify, or that there's a reason I can't be made whole, and that I'm going to get something in return that's less than what I really originally had. But if we're all working earnestly toward the goal of insurance is to make people whole. So this functions as a bit of an unspoken ceiling of our expectations. We're all working below the joy line. The joy line kind of limits our expectations of what might happen as we work together in sort of the client and insurer relationship. I don't mean that all insurance people are not joyous or that joy doesn't happen in the insurance industry. This is me with a crew from Suncorp, an Australian insurance company that I worked with in 2015. These were very happy people, very smart people. So happiness and joy are happening in the insurance industry. I'm really talking about a mental framing of the insurance industry, and I'm trying to mess with that. The idea came to me back around 2015 when my wife and I both became advisors to Trove, which is a startup in the Bay Area that helps you insure valuable things and then do on-demand insurance, meaning you take a picture of your bicycle, your expensive downhill bicycle, and then you insure it only during the weekend that you're out riding, because when it's in the garage, it's insured under your homeowner's or your renter's insurance, for example. You can also send them a picture of the barcodes on the bike or the receipt, preferably on your bike, an emailed receipt, and that will register it, and then they know a lot about the bicycle. And I suddenly got thinking, well, gosh, now they know an awful lot about the intimate things in your life. And here comes a key word, which is everything else I'm about to describe depends entirely on you, the insurer, having permission to do these things, which then revolves around trust. You have to have asked for permission, but you really need to be a trusted party. And this whole notion of operating from trust is a larger issue, as you'll see as I expand on these topics. But I'm in the middle of designing a process I call Design from Trust, and this joy line idea is part of that project. Joy master that everybody probably is familiar with is Zappos, this funny shoe company that now sells lots more than shoes. They sell wow. They empower their customer service reps. Now, customer service is typically the cost center that you bury in the basement, and you time people to make sure that they get off the phone as quickly as possible because they are a cost to be minimized. Zappos has entirely the opposite idea about the people in their call centers. Those people are empowered to deliver wow, to do really interesting things. The story I heard Tony Hsieh, the founder, say years ago was that he and some other executives were out of town at some conference. And just for fun, they called into the call center. He did not identify himself as the CEO of the company, and he said, you know, I'd like a pizza. And the rep, instead of saying, gosh, we don't actually sell pizzas, thanks for calling, bye-bye, said, where are you? And within seconds had Googled and transmitted the information about the four nearest pizza parlors to where he was staying. And he tells this story knowing that it will carry, that I just told it to you and that other people will tell it, because wow is free advertising in one sense, but wow also makes people happy up and down all over the place. So I'm interested in exploring that space above the joy line, and to do so, let's imagine that you have one of those fancy downhill expensive mountain bikes. And now let's imagine what I might help you do with that bike. So you might use it more. If I had a lot of permission, I might notice that you haven't gone downhill biking in 6 months, 8 months, and it's not just because it was winter, but you're actually not using the bike. So I could, with your permission, notify you that it's a great weekend for a mountain bike trip, or provide some motivation for you in different ways that let you use it more. That's kind of simple. I could also help you use that bike better. Maybe there's techniques you'd like to learn. There's certainly a surfeit of videos on YouTube explaining everything, including downhill biking. I could hook you up with a local tutor. I could connect you with other people who do mountain biking in your area. A little bit of research would tell me that there's a group that meets regularly on Sundays, something like that, and you could join them. I could basically become a social connector for you using this object that you have, that I know you have, and some permission to begin facilitating that. I could help you use that bike differently. You may not have heard of cyclocross yet, but cyclocross is sort of like an obstacle course while riding and carrying your bicycle across bridges, across fences, and through muddy fields, all sorts of things. Cyclocross is picking up. It's an awful lot of fun. But maybe you've never heard of it, so I could provide you that service and connect you up with the next cyclocross meet that's happening in your neighborhood. I could notice that your bike is 10, 15 years old, and you might actually like to upgrade because you're using it a lot, and I could help you then figure out what is the best path given who you are, what you prefer, and what I know. And insurers know an awful lot about stuff. They know repair records, they know what gets stolen a lot, they know a whole lot of things about stuff. I could use my wisdom to help you upgrade to a better bike. I could also help you put your bike in the sharing economy so that other people could benefit from the existence of your bike. And maybe you're not riding it as much as you'd like because you're traveling a whole lot, and you'd like to meet other people who borrow your bike and put it back. So that could be pretty interesting. I could also help you sell it. Let's say you haven't used it in a long time and it's sitting in your garage. So in the back of your head, there's this constant loop of, man, somebody's just gonna break in and steal it. We're beginning to realize as we're getting past the idea that we're mere consumers, we're beginning to realize that stuff weighs us down and getting rid of stuff is good. And again, an insurance company knows a lot about the object I have, so you might help me price it, sell it, you could easily create a very beautiful post I could put on Craigslist or someplace else, and we could sell it in a really nice way. Or I could gift it. And by this, I don't mean necessarily to donate it to some charity, which is a really great thing to do, but also I mean, when you die, is your bike or whatever this thing is that you value a lot, is it in your will? And whom would you like to bequeath it to? Now we're opening up a whole different conversation, right? So all these things I just mentioned open up a ton of new opportunities for conversations with your client. And formerly your touch point was, let's see, I'm shopping for insurance. Then at some point I decide to buy it and I buy from you, and now I have an onboarding process, which is more or less complicated. And then you talk to me once a year for the renewal, which I'm not that eager to pay, and I've probably put on auto pay anyway, so that conversation goes away. I don't really want your newsletter, your normal everybody newsletter. And then incidents show up. And if you're a really great insurer, both of us leave that incident smiling because it got handled very professionally, very quickly, and very fairly. But that isn't always the case. So we kind of rue the incidents. Now we have opportunities to be in front of you with reminders, to help you improve your lifestyle, to connect you with trainers and tutors, or provide some tutoring ourselves on some of the most used items. Use the 80-20 rule here, the Pareto principle. To connect you with other people who care about the things you care about, maybe to be a very relevant newsfeed within particular bounds, or to connect you up with somebody who is a terrific newsfeed about cyclocross, for example. To be your host and guide into the sharing economy, to make product recommendations, price evaluations, estate planning, right? This is all, some of these things are other forms of insurance, some of these are other businesses altogether. So, all the benefits I just named are immediate benefits for clients. And it turns out that you can make a little 2x2 and do immediate benefits also for the insurance company itself, and higher order benefits for clients and insurers, which will become clear in a sec when I get there. But first, let's go to immediate benefits for insurers, which include, as I just described, many new touch points. So all of a sudden you have all these new conversations that can lead to new business ideas for you, things that your customers actually would like to have that you can then deliver, could lead to a whole series of new partnerships, because you don't have to be all the things that I just talked about. There are entities out there that exist that are doing this, the sharing economy, that are doing collective ride, bicycle rides, et cetera, et cetera. You can be a bridge builder between these, but you can make those bridges actually partnerships. All of this creates new meaning, purpose, fun, play, improves morale for your employees. And I think this is really important, is that making people whole is good. You're always sort of you're fixing the thing that's broken, but actually rethinking it so that your role is to suddenly is loaded with a lot more meaning and purpose is really inspiring. And suddenly you get intrinsic motivation that you didn't have before. So this kind of improves life for insurers as well as clients. Now, higher order. What do I mean? Well, you, the insurer, are now helping hack my happiness. You're trying to improve my subjective well-being. That's truly interesting. And you haven't really been doing that before now. You're helping me possibly find my tribe, my group, connect with others. You're helping me pass my things on well, which is estate planning. You're helping me learn what enough might mean for me. Now, everybody might not be into it. Some people are more of the mode of he who dies with the most toys wins, and that certainly makes for more insurable objects. That's true. But a whole bunch of people are starting to figure out that stuff weighs us down, that there's this sort of open loop in the back of your head about somebody's going to steal it, or I don't use it enough. You feel either guilt or fear around it. So what does it mean to have enough? And I think pondering this word enough is really interesting because it involves lifestyle change. It involves reevaluating the things you have. This is a very deep conversation. So some of your clients are really going to enjoy this conversation about what does enough mean, and that will let you enter other kinds of relationships with them. For insurers, the higher order benefits are really, you're reframing the entire insurance industry, which formerly ended where the joy line is and now includes a lot of higher space, space where you can invent new things. You are now aligning yourself with your clients' higher needs, their higher order needs, like hacking their happiness. You are now pulling on that rope in the same direction together. That's really interesting. Your employees now hopefully have a new sense of agency. They have a lot more authority to do things, to bring wow, to bring joy to the clients at the other end. So here's the quadrant. Here's all four of the sections that we've just gone through. It's a lot of things, right? It's a lot of new territory. In fact, a lot of this isn't just about insurance. I think that this is possibly about how to use stuff better in your life. And it's not just stuff. So some important notes. First, you have to get permission. Permission is mandatory. Otherwise, this is stalking. You've heard of the stalker economy. Well, we are nose deep in the stalker economy already. Just look at the Facebook and Cambridge Analytica fiasco. Look at what China is doing with their social credit system. We are already well into the stalking economy, which is a pretty big breach of faith and trust. So permission is really essential here. That means also that you have to be quite trustworthy. So you need to do an internal audit, an internal inspection, figure out where do you breach trust? What are the things that you might be doing that you don't even realize breach trust, like advertising? And I've got some videos online that talk about that. The things you've been doing below the joy line still really matter. Everybody sort of below decks in the engine room, fulfilling claims, doing estimates, risk estimates, to all those kinds of things, they really still matter. In fact, you need to execute better on those sorts of things. And as you've probably already started pondering, this isn't just about your downhill bike or the jewelry that you're insuring or that Hasselblad camera or that that purse that's worth $30,000. This is really about everything, including services. And look at how the insurance industry is increasingly covering more and more things. All of those things could come under the purview of this idea of working above the joy line. Finally, and this is sort of maybe a subtle note, but I think it's really an important note, I'm not trying to recommend new forms of emotional labor or emotional work. I'm borrowing here, I'm paraphrasing Arlie Russell Hochschild, who's done a lot of work on this, and I hope I get it right because I'm not quite sure that I'm striking the same tone she would strike. But emotional labor is what happens when you climb on the plane and the flight attendant says, "Good day, sir. How was your afternoon? Welcome to our flight." And like, they've got a big smile on their face much of the time. Their job is to be happy. Their job is to be upbeat and project some of that enthusiasm. That is emotional labor, where the presence of emotions is required as part of your work. Emotional work is very different. Emotional work is the work of attending to emotions in a group or with another person that you work with. So when the assistant says, "You know, now is not a really good time to visit Bob. He had a terrible meeting an hour ago. He's really pissed off." That's emotional work. You've just provided a little bit of guidance to the person coming in that the emotions are kind of rocky right now. When you're in a meeting and you say, "You know, Susan, I noticed you haven't had an opportunity to say what you think. Would you like to jump into the conversation?" That's emotional work. Now, unfortunately, in our cultures, emotional work often gets picked up by women. They're the ones who notice it more. They're the ones who take care of it more. It is an unpaid aspect of work. It doesn't show up in the job description. It doesn't show up in the interview. And yet we all know that it happens all the time. Some of these issues are pretty deep, so look for a couple of videos I'm going to produce after this one. One is called Stalk or Serve, which is about this whole idea about not stalking, but what does it mean to serve well? And the second one is called Being a Trusted Ally, which is, I think, the high ground in trust in a marketplace. So today, the insurance industry frames things like this, that the ceiling of on our expectations is that I'm going to make you whole, I'm going to bring you back up to where you were before. This whole conversation has been about expanding that frame and opening up a series of new opportunities, of new conversations, of new business possibilities, really rethinking how the industry even works. If we looked at healthcare, mostly healthcare is a break-fix kind of problem, right? There's a little bit of preventative care happening, much more in other countries, but in the US, mostly you show up with something and I try to fix it. So what if we worked above the joy line in healthcare? And you can start looking at other things. The example I used with Zappos was in retail. So there's plenty of opportunities in other kinds of domains. This whole presentation has been part of a larger project I call Design from Trust. If you want to know more about it, go to designfromtrust.com. If you'd like to join the process of designing Design from Trust, send me an email. I'll put my email in the information box below this video. And I will add you to a conversational mailing list where we're figuring out what on earth this thing is. But for now, thanks for watching, and good luck making this happen.